Today we are going to talk about these topics. Number 1, are friends happy being with you? Number 2, top 10 list of what to do and what not to do in relationships. Number 3, love lies, betrayal and deceit. Why do we lie to those we love? Number 4, hatred, the byproduct of a bad breakup. Number 5, refreshing your relationship schedule, some fun time. Number 1, we all have different style of talking, laughing, smiling, responding and communicating. Some of us are a comfort for others. We enjoy being with some people and we don't enjoy some people. What is the difference between these persons? Why one person presence enlivens the gathering and other person dulls it? What are the qualities needed to make oneself socially popular? Smile, every first quality is smile. When we see somebody smiling, we feel pleased. And if the smile is without any malice, it is more enchanting. Keep smiling. Keep your problems with yourself and keep your face smiling. Listening, when we don't speak but only listen, people love us. All of us have our own problems and need somebody to listen to us. Become a good listener. Ask open-ended questions such as, and after that? Why? And so on. That will encourage the speaker to pour out all to you. Have something funny to say, there is enough pain in the world. Bring in some laughter. Have a collection of jokes and make your friends laugh. The more they laugh, the more they will enjoy your company. Appreciate, have a word of appreciation for everyone. You can appreciate somebody's clothes, or shoes or whatever. Appreciate. Make friends feel good. To be friendly and to be charming is not an art. It can be easily developed by all of us. The only need is to pay less attention to ourselves and more to others. Make friends happy and they will love your presence. Make your presence a life of any gathering. Success is yours. Number 2, most of us who have been intimately involved with someone beyond the infatuation stage know that relationships are like a roller coaster ride. When things are good, they are very, very good. When things are bad, they are very, very bad. As a relationship coach, I have developed top 10 lists, one for men and one for women, on 10 things to do and not to do in relationships. Mendo 1. Just listen to your partner without offering advice. 2. Trust and respect her. 3. Treat her as an equal partner in your relationship. 4. Stay and support her when she gets emotional. She is looking for understanding, not solutions. 5. Continue your courtship even after she's committed to you. Continue to create romance in your relationship. 6. Do little things on a regular basis. A woman doesn't care if you call her at work to say, I love you, or if you buy a new TV for the living room. The small things are worth just as much as the big ones. 7. Honor any agreements you have made with her. 8. Encourage her goals and direction. 9. Find out what your partner would like to do and then do it with her. 10. Say, I'm sorry, when you've done something you regret or that was hurtful to your partner, whether intentionally or unintentionally. T1. Go to bed angry with your partner. 2. Try to offer advice or solutions when your partner just needs you to listen to her without comment. 3. Pretend to listen to her when you really aren't. 4. Shut your partner out when you need to sort things out in your head. Just explain you need space, you aren't angry with your partner and that you'll be back. 5. Criticize your partner, especially her appearance. 6. Yell at your partner as if you were her father. 7. Take every word she says literally. Women, when upset, tend to speak in absolutes, such as you never listen to me, when what she really means is that you aren't listening to her at that time. 8. Allow jealousy to erode the trust, love and respect of your relationship. 9. Violate her privacy. 10. Forget special occasions. Men and women have different communication styles, different needs and desires, and different relationship challenges. Learning these differences can assist us in strengthening the relationships we have now and in the future. John Gray began this revolutionary discovery in his book, Men Are From Mars. Women Are From Venus. The women's list follows. Womendo 1. When you want more quality time with your man, make the time you do have as positive as possible. 2. Trust and respect him. 3. Stop nagging. 4. Allow your partner time away from you without giving him the third degree. 5. Appreciate the little things he does for you and tell him so. 6. Make love creatively and often. Don't be afraid to initiate lovemaking. 7. Honor any agreements you have made with him. 8. Support his goals and direction. 9. Ask for what you want. 10. Accept his no gracefully, trusting that he would if he could. (T1) Go to bed angry with your partner. 2. Insist he always share his feelings with you. Talking about feelings is more what women need. 3. Attempt to converse with your partner during a good movie or a sporting event. 4. Continue to give in what you perceive as a lopsided relationship when you are at a point of resentment. 5. Criticize him or put him down, especially the things he does. 6. Scold your partner as if he were a child. 7. Use sex as a prize for good behavior or the withholding of sex as punishment for bad behavior. 8. Compare him to a fictional character in a book, movie or soap drama and find him lacking. 9. Violate his privacy. 10. Try to change him. Appreciate the man he is right now. There is so much to learn about satisfying relationships that your parents never showed you. Please don't become one of the statistics of divorce or perhaps worse, stay in a miserable relationship to honor your marriage vows while having so many regrets about your life as the time ticks away. Number 3. Why do husbands and wives, boyfriends and girlfriends, lie to each other? Our romantic relationships are seldom what they seem. We all want a relationship that is built on openness, intimacy, and trust, but the truth is, our relationships do not always work that way. More often than not, our intimate relationships involve secrecy and deceit. In fact, if you want to look for deception and betrayal in your own life, the best place to start is close to home. Husbands and wives, boyfriends and girlfriends, often lie about their true feelings for each other, the feelings they have for others, and their level of commitment. Indeed, it is safe to say that people save their biggest and most serious lies for those they love. For better or worse, our romantic relationships are full of paradoxes which we try to overlook, downplay and ignore. For the most part, this strategy works well. Until the day comes when it doesn't, and with little warning or preparation we have to confront face on the reality that our close relationships are not exactly what they appear to be. Eventually, almost everyone will catch a spouse or partner in one of their lies. Inevitably, we have a difficult time coping with what we have learned and dealing with the fact that someone close has betrayed our trust. We do not expect our partners to mislead us, nor do we have insight into how and why deception occurs. In fairness, it should also be mentioned that it is just as likely that a partner or spouse will catch you in one of your own attempts to deceive. And ironically, we are just as unprepared to deal with this kind of situation. Ignoring the paradoxes inherent in our romantic relationships turns out to be a costly strategy and most people pay the price for this decision, unexpectedly, and all at once. It's not so much that coming to terms with the use of deception in romantic relationships will solve all of the problems you are going to encounter, but it will certainly help to reduce the stress, anxiety, and uncertainty that occur when deception eventually comes to light. In fact, when it comes to love and romance, most of the things we believe are not true. Most people believe that all of their marital or relational problems can be solved through communication. We believe that deception is difficult to achieve, that misleading a partner requires a lot of effort and thought, and that romantic partners can tell when a lover is lying, and so on. None of these widely held beliefs, however, are supported by the evidence. Rather, our romantic relationships are held together by a delicate balance of both candor and deceit. And both are critical to making our intimate relationships work. In reality, romantic relationships entail two important features which allow deception to flourish: abundant opportunity, as well as the need to deceive. As we get close to another person, we intentionally and unintentionally provide them with a great deal of information about who we are, revealing ourselves through both our words and deeds. Creating this kind of intimacy or shared knowledge is critical, as it serves as the foundation for a lot of important rewards. Through our close relationships, we create gains with respect to our health, wealth, and emotional well-being. Because relationships provide so many important rewards, it should come as no surprise that people are inclined to view their romantic partners in a positive light. We place a lot of trust in our romantic partners. We think we know them well. But while our trust surely provides us with a sense of security and comfort, it also lays the ground for deceit. For as we trust our partners more, we also become more confident, but less accurate at determining when the truth is being told. Every relevant study attests to the fact that lovers are terrible at telling when their partners are lying. In fact, detecting deception with anyone is difficult to do, but lovers manage to take this general failure to a spectacular low. Again, as we become more confident that we can tell when a lover is lying, the exact opposite turns out to be true. This truth bias, or blind faith, provides a perfect opportunity for romantic partners to engage in deception. After all, who makes a better victim than someone who is eager and willing to trust everything you have to say? Not only do close relationships create a wonderful opportunity for deception to occur, they also create the need. While romantic relationships offer many rewards, they also tend to be overly constrictive. Most everyone has felt the constraints of a close relationship from time to time. Quite simply, you are no longer free to do what you want, when you want, and with whom you want. So intimacy provides tremendous rewards, but at an enormous cost, the loss of your freedom and autonomy. Lying to a romantic partner helps us deal with the constraints that our intimate relationships impose. Quite frankly, deceiving a romantic partner turns out to be the most efficient and effective way of maintaining the rewards we get from our romantic relationships while pursuing extra-relational goals and activities behind a partner's back. How do we decide when to lie and when to tell the truth? Well, most of the time we do not intentionally think about misleading our partners. Rather, such decisions are governed by our emotions and just seem to happen when the right situation presents itself. Often a sense of excitement, opportunity, and exhilaration can lead us down paths we had no intention of traveling. A sense of fear, loss, and trepidation, on the other hand, prompt us to cover up what we've done and be more conservative in the short term. Luckily, our emotions are very good at reading situations and keeping our deceptive behavior within limits. Our emotions prompt us to regain some of our freedoms while also allowing us to maintain the benefits we get from our intimate relationships. When you take a step back and put it all together, the picture that emerges tends to be rather ironic. Because our romantic relationships are so rewarding yet constrictive, we are simultaneously more truthful and more deceptive with those we love. Additionally, we place the most trust in the person who is most likely to deceive us, just as we are most likely to deceive the person who loves and trusts us the most. These are just a few of the paradoxes that emerge when taking a close look at the use of deception in our romantic relationships. Most of what is uncovered runs counter to our most cherished beliefs about love and romance. That is, the idea that complete openness and intimacy are a central and defining feature of being in love. Initially, most people avoid looking for deception by a loved one. But as you begin to examine your own behavior more closely, it becomes harder to dismiss the degree to which lies, betrayal, secrecy, and deceit are ever present in our close relationships. Hopefully, you will take on a greater appreciation for the complexities of your relationships as well as a richer understanding of what it means to be in love. Regardless of the final outcome, taking a close look at deception in your life will change the way you view yourself and others. Number 4. Breakups are a most difficult part of life and relationships. When you are first starting that relationship, everything is new and exciting. Many times, as the relationship wears on, it becomes hard to be with someone who may not be right for you. As a result, many couples give up. Breakups can be amenable, but much of the time it is a very ugly situation. After a breakup, it is very common to feel disgust, contempt, or even hatred for your ex-significant other. If you have broken up with someone or someone has broken up with you and you are experiencing hatred toward them, this is a very unhealthy scenario. There are several reasons to try to get over the hatred you feel for your ex. First, it is not healthy for you. Another reason is that there is no guarantee that your ex is as miserable as you are. The final reason is that you will find peace with yourself if you can get past this feeling of scorn. The first reason to try to get over the hatred you feel for an ex is that it is physically unhealthy for you. This hatred that you feel for your ex causes extreme stress and unrest. This can be very bad for your body, as stress, not resolved, is a very harmful hormone that is released throughout your body. Seeds of hate can eat away at your physical body in a manner that is totally unhealthy. Being stressed out over something can make you physically sick. Stress has even been known to contribute to a irregular heartbeat. Your health is certainly more important than stressing over a past relationship. Another reason to move past hatred you are feeling is that your misery may be one-sided. If you are hung up on your ex and are obsessing over your hatred of him or her every day, you may be the only one suffering. The case may be that your ex has moved on completely and doesn't even think about your relationship anymore. While you are being eaten up by a caustic emotion, the person who is the object of your hate is not even fazed. That is pretty unfair when you think about it. The final reason to get over your hatred for someone you used to date, besides your physical health, is your emotional health. Just as your physical health can be affected and deteriorate, your emotional health can do much the same thing. Hatred is an emotion that can torment the person experiencing it. You might begin to become reclusive, and you might withdraw from your normal routines and friends. This is definitely not emotionally healthy for you. Overall, it is just not a good idea to let anger and hatred get the best of you. There are so many negative effects on your personal life that you should try your best to, if you can't forgive, forget. Though it won't be easy like flipping a switch, you can talk yourself out of a negative mood and into a positive mood if you repeat the effort every single day. Remind yourself that you are a great person and that, when you are ready, someone else will be very lucky to be in a relationship with you. Keep your eyes focused on the future instead of the past, and you will find the inner strength to get you over your hate and get on with your life after a bitter breakup. Number 5. Ask anyone in a committed long-term union for the secret of their success. Almost always, one of the top 3 reasons cited is the ability to laugh together. No matter how big the problems, or how many the obstacles, they will be most effectively approached with a sense of humor and the teamwork that emerges from shared laughter and a mutually positive outlook. While some fun costs money, an amusement park, a fine meal out, a trip to Vegas, or that hilarious new movie, there are many fun activities that don't cost a dime. Give your partner the gift or being a slave for a week, including the requisite master or mistress verbiage, pulling your forelock, bowing or curtsying, and backing out of the room. The results can be very funny, especially if carried into public or in front of the kids. Both of you call in sick to work and play hooky, hang out at the mall like truant high school sophomores. Spend some time coming up with totally outrageous excuses that you know you will never be able to deliver with a straight face. If it's summer, wash the car, and each other, in the driveway. If it's winter, have a snowball fight or walk in the rain. Walk along the beach or in the hills or stroll through town window shopping. Watch television together, not the dreary news but old Seinfeld or Lucy reruns, which are just as funny as when they were made. Search out joke sites on the internet or spend some time at the drugstore just looking at funny greeting cards. Tell stories about things that happened to you before you met and reminisce about the fun times you've had since you first became an item. Take a foreign language class at a local adult school and decide that you will only communicate in that language over dinner. If nothing else, it will really polish your charades ability. Take an art class and laugh at your own ineptness with color and perspective. Take a bus or train ride and make up stories about the other passengers, sing karaoke and mutually laugh at the probable response your efforts would elicit if you auditioned for American Idol. Pretend you've just met and try out some stale pickup lines to see each other's reaction. Life is so short and there are so many problems that arise and challenges that must be faced. At times, we become overwhelmed by the responsibilities we must bear and the energy required to keep our lives on an even keel. Deliberately establishing recess periods gives us a break from the daily grind. Just as children don't learn well if they don't have a chance to go out and play, adults need a recess too. It allows us to return to work re-energized and renewed. The more we practice it, the more frequent it will become. Most importantly, the playtime with our partner intensifies our relationship and can keep our affection green and growing through the years ahead.